Good morning. I'm happy to welcome you to the last morning session of this symposium. This symposium, which has already by now become a kind of adventuring trip through the complex and evasive fields of imagination. This symposium is structured interdisciplinary, and events of this kind sometimes are as stimulating as distracting. In our case, it's most astonishing that in all fields, even in the most unbound outbursts of preliminary ideas, there are to be observed mechanisms, if not rules, which can be transferred. One wonders if not a general science of the creative process as such as Picasso was looking for would not be possible. This morning we shift the perspective again towards a field which is becoming more and more important in our time, the visual epistemology of natural science and mathematics, a field that only in the last decades has more and more become accepted in the history of science. We have one change. The last speaker, the fourth speaker, will not show up, so that we take the chance that Leo Treitler will step in again and will propose theses for a more general perspective after the break. So at first we will have two papers and then the break and then another two papers. Our speakers are more than prepared for the subject. Jean Dombre, directeur d'études à l'École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, is a vibrant spirit who has taught mathematics at a number of universities, among them Paris, Nantes, Bangkok, Singapore, and Ottawa. He was and is member of a breathtaking number of highest-rated institutes, committees, and societies. He has founded the prestigious journal Sciences et Techniques en Perspective and is director of other journals as well. He has written numerous articles and books in mathematics and the history of science, among them Des Sargues en son temps, which bridges also mathematics and art history. It deals also with the mathematics of perspective of the 17th century as then was developed by Abraham Bosse, who is a person of art history. So please.
Well, the idea that there exists some kind of creation in mathematics was not familiar to the intellectual tradition of the Western world. And this was true for the scholastic world as well as for the modern world, which was molded by the Renaissance and then transformed by the so-called scientific revolution, a really bad name for a move that lasted a century at least, and for which everyone agrees that mathematics played some role. The weight of Euclid's Elements, with its innumerable commentaries, the work of the bees, Mark Fumaroli would have said, and in the Islamic world as well, I suppose then prevented any understanding of the existence of any kind of a creative process in forms of mathematical activity. So that the main idea was restoration of Euclid. This was the main representation of mathematics, with the idea at the end of the 16th century that a perfect Euclid was possible, ab omni naivo vindicatus. A book better than Euclid, but an imitation. Now, perhaps there is a rich and ambiguous meaning in the story told long ago by Gilberte Pascal or Madame Perrier about her younger brother, Blaise Pascal. The way she told the story may help us understand the dramatic change in the representation of mathematics in the 17th century. Blaise Pascal had supposedly recovered alone till the 32nd proposition of Euclid's first book. But a recovery of old thoughts is no creation at all. It has to be called an imitatio, which, as in classical terminology, requires genius. Son génie pour la géométrie commença à apparaître qu'il n'avait que 12 ans. Par une rencontre si extraordinaire qu'elle mérite bien d'être déduite en particulier. His genius for geometry began or appeared only when he was 12, but in such strange meeting or concourse, which is so extraordinary that it has to be deduced, that's a word used, deduced in a particular way. What is there to be deduced? Why then Pascal's father, épouvanté de la grandeur et de la puissance de ce génie, completely frightened by the magnitude of the power of his son's mind, genius? As Blaise was just able to recover the evidence of reason at work on mathematical and elementary figures, the father, Étienne Pascal, had forbidden his son to read any geometric books so that the young man might concentrate on his learning of Latin when he was 12 years old, which is rather old to learn Latin at the time. If we read some line further and if we try to understand what could have been so devastating in the evidence of reason, finding the 32 first Euclid's proposition. Well, nobody ever claimed to have done that. And even when the Jesuit fathers came to China, they were not thinking that there could be a Euclid in China. They were thinking that they had to translate, and this was the first book ever translated from the Western world into China, Euclid's Elements. Now, we read a little bit further about the experiment on the void, which the young Blaise had reproduced from Torricelli. Gilbert then uses a completely different word, not genius, the word invention, with the rhetorical meaning of it, inventio, which means a well-organized and consistent discourse, duly prepared, not a sketch. Il inventa ensuite et exécuta l'autre, qu'on nomme l'expérience du vide, qui prouve si clairement que tous les effets qu'on avait jusque-là attribués au vide sont causés par la pesanteur de l'air. He then invented this experience. What is invented? The proof. Not the experiment. Well, the experiment is from Torricelli. So the invention of the proof that everything which has been attributed to the void was in fact due to the weight of air. Now, immediately afterwards, Gilbert says that this was the last thing Pascal did about human sciences, sciences humaines. She adds, et quoi qu'il ait inventé la roulette après, cela ne contredit pas ce que je dis, car il la trouva sans y penser, et d'une manière qui fait bien croire qu'il n'y avait pas d'application. He found it, he invented it, without thinking to it. And this is not a contradiction, so she says, because this proves that he was not so immersed with human things that he had to think in mathematical things. So precisely what is there being said, no sketch at all. Now, the absence of preparation is what Gilberte precisely is saying when she offers a portrait of her brother as not concerned with secular or concupiscent thoughts. Remember, this adjective, concupiscent, was used and applied to geometry, so did Antoine Arnauld, and in a book clearly inspired by Pascal himself, with the task of replacing axioms in geometry by just evidence of reason. Now we are at the place. There couldn't be any relation with tradition. Evidence of reason is one's own mind. And tradition has to be forgotten. Mathematics, for the first time, was now considered as simple, obvious. Well, if you think of it, it means also, and this is the price to be paid, that a mathematician is not allowed to sketch because his mind parallels nature for which there exists no sketches. Which means that when Gilberte is speaking about physics or physis, or better said, when she is speaking about philosophiae naturalis, then indeed she uses the word almost creation. And she says that Pascal invented the proof. Now, when we compare to the usual saying of the scholastic world, mathematicus supponit quod physicus demonstrat, the mathematician supposes what the physicist proves. Well, who could say any longer such a thing? But then it means something concerning invention and sketches in mathematics. Let me give one thing to avoid a bad, which I think would be a wrong idea. Gilberte's story never tries to explain that Pascal worked on intuition. She doesn't mention geometric figures, even if she was not a mathematician. Gilberte is very careful in the vocabulary she uses. Il cherchait les proportions des figures entre elles. He was looking for the proportions figures, geometric figures, had one to another, to find proportion in geometrical figures, or to use analogia, which is a true Greek term for it, may certainly bring contemplatio once the result is obtained. That is, first of all, there is a rhetorical organization of a proof. So proportion theory, as it was developed in book 5 of Euclid's Element, and not in the book Pascal was supposed to have reconstructed, is a kind of algebra used to compare quantities one to another. It is outside number theory, it's the only mathematical and general theory as such left by mathematicians of the Hellenistic school, on which Galileo was able to create a new world, the language of the world, as it said. Is it now possible that a sketch could exist only once algebraical tools and terminology was used, because they carry an evidence which has to be explained? Now, the question of evidence of reason, simplicity of mathematics, is really the question of sketch for mathematics at this moment. The idea being that there cannot be a sketch when you prove something in a logical way. Or, to say it otherwise, this time was the time where logic was changed, put in a natural form. That is, it was considered as obvious. Think of l'art de penser, of Arnauld and Antoine. It was considered as obvious, natural, to think logically. Mathematics is something else. Now, I would like, just to avoid this idea concerning geometric figures and intuition, a little bit to get rid of Kant in Anschauung and so on. I would just like, because the question of sketch raises such question, ontological question, I would just like to ask, what is mathematics really in a sketch of mathematics? And I would like to use a drawing, and I use it from, not from the 17th century, but from the early 19th century, and you understand, will very quickly understand why. I'd like to speak about the invention. It was in 1817, exactly, by Alexander von Humboldt, of the so-called isotherms. But the first thing I would like to show is what are isotherms. What should I do? No. No? Yes, I must be creative. Clearly. So on the right side. Good. Sorry. So just the idea, it's very simple. The idea of what isotherms are, such very strange line, very erratic lines on the globe. Okay? Is there any mathematics in it? I claim no. These are lines, representation, whatever you think of it, numerical data. Now, what are the isotherms invented by Alexander von Humboldt? Completely different drawing. First of all, you don't have the Earth. You have mathematics. But what? What when I say there is mathematics? Well, you may say first, and that could be the Kantian Anschauung, or the idea of intuition a priori. Isotherms are the lines which are replacing latitudes. You see latitudes, and then you have isotherms. That's not at all how Alexander von Humboldt explains the thing. What he says is the property of the curves are the two inflections. That is, there is a structural property of the curve saying that it goes like that. Up, down, up, down. So you may say it's a sinusoidal move. No, no, no. But there are inflections. That's a mathematical property. So you see here, there cannot be a sketch of a proof. The proof is there. The proof is in saying that there exist ideal lines having a mathematical property which can be described by two points of inflection, and that's it. Now, simplicity, no sketch in a way, except that the sketch is in the proof, or the proof is a sketch. Now, we have to move a little bit further. But before doing that, I just would like to show you an extraordinary painting by Max Ernst called Humboldt. And I don't want to comment. Simplicity? Sketch. Proof. But the world is global. The curve, isotherms, covers the whole world. Now it explains why, and this will be my last comment about Humboldt. It explains this bad taste caricature or drawing about Humboldt. Think, he was able to think the cosmos in a mathematical way. Completely explained, structured. Oh, just for temperature. Yes, just for temperature. Now, I have to go to, I wanted to show some of a portrait of Humboldt, but this won't be the place. And I suppose, the time as well, I would like to go to the main part of what I wanted to say, that is, and forget, I won't discuss too much about the criticism I would like to argue about Kantian argument, but go immediately to the main example, which is taken by, which comes from a manuscript written during the winter 1691. It was written in Paris because Jean Bernoulli had been invited to Paris to give lectures at the Academy of Sciences, and he was well paid for it. And this manuscript has been found during the 20th century, was not used before, was not published by Bernoulli. It is the first explanation of differential and integral calculus. I mean, and integral calculus. So this is, I take a page. It is written, you get the impression that it is clearly and nicely written. So the first problem is problem 5. We're at the very beginning of the manuscript. And the first problem is to find a curve for which a subtangent is constant. So it's not a question of differential calculus. It's already a question of integral calculus. But look, you have the drawing, very, very simple, which may explain what a subtangent is and what I want to show concerning sketches. You have a curve. There is a line. Oh, which line? There is a line which goes through a point of the curve but doesn't cut the curve in any other point, I mean, locally. Okay, that's a tangent. Call it like that. And now you move a little bit the point. And there appear two triangles, a small one, very small one, which is the so-called characteristic triangle, and a larger one, this one. Now, what you want to show, what you want to think is, define geometrically the tangent by what? By this distance. This distance here will be called the subtangent. Invenire sum tangentius. Now, what is obvious? If you have a frame of reference means you use x and y. That's a way to do it. If you have a frame of reference, now it's obvious. Because here, if you put it y, what you want to know is there, and that is dx. You don't have to give a meaning to it. It is a variation of the variable x, that's it. That you have dy. Look, this over this is this over this. Dy over dx is y over what I want to know, that's it. I have it. And now, if I want to find a curve, the subtangent of which is constant, dy over dx is y over a constant. I have to think. Well, this is here, written. There is a technique, which I can't explain, because this is not sketched. It is proved, completely proved, in one line only, how this curve should be the logarithmic curve. Now, I want to show you how I would like to go a little bit further with the second problem, but it is related to, I needed the first one. The second problem is how you do with when you have a specific curve. Which curve do you you may think of? Well, invenire tangentem cycloidis. This was the curve of the 17th century, a curve which the antique authors never considered. This was the spider curve, to use the technique or the rhetoric of Marc Fumaroli. Now, you do exactly the same. I mean, you move a little bit, and you compare triangle. Now, what you obtain, but look, I want to show what you obtain now uses computation. Here it was easy, because it was something you exhibit a property subtangent. Here it's no longer easy. You have to mix two things. You have to interpret dx and dy in terms of how you compute when you differentiate. Look, it's enough to see what happens here. And the result is that the tangent to the cycloid is parallel to this chord of the generating circle. It's not obvious. You have to compute. And look, the poor Bernoulli, not the poor, had problems. You see the modifications he had to do on his computation? He's the first, almost the first one to do so, and he makes mistakes. But it's not a sketch. They are the usual steps concerning computations. Now, once this is being shown, I would like to show perhaps the end of the proof. The mixing, so it ends here. The mixing of computation, and then you go back to et per consequens tangens equalis et parallela subtangentia BH. Okay? Computation, interpretation. Now, the courses given by Jean Bernoulli were followed by a certain number of persons, and particularly by the Marquis de l'Hôpital, Marquis de Saint-Mesme. Now, 4 years later, he published something which is called Analyse des infiniment petits pour servir à l'intelligence des lignes courbes, the analysis of the infinitely small in order to understand curves. And you'll find the same, almost the same drawing like in Bernoulli, put with almost the same setting of computation, but with a difference. The difference is the idea, the aim, perhaps the objective of Bernoulli is modified. It looks, so it's approximately the same drawing, a circle. This is the cycloid. And what you have to prove is exactly the same thing. The tangent to the cycloid is the same, is parallel to the chord of the generating circle. Okay, same thing. No computation. Almost no computation. Oh yes, the computation you see here, it's a usual writing for similar triangles. I already pronounced it. Dx over dy multiplied by y and so on. The same. Yes, but not difficult computation, because the aim with having exactly the same drawing is different. What is it to say? It is to generate the idea of what a general subtangent here. It is to generate the idea than a curve. When it is represented according to a certain frame of reference, Cartesian frame of reference, looks in a certain way. If you change your frame of reference, but you keep the same geometrical curve, you have the same idea of subtangent, but you have to change your computation. So now, the idea is to say that the subtangent of this curve, when you look at the curve represented by this circular curve, no longer by the axis. That is, if you use a curve as a frame of reference for another curve, you keep the idea of subtangent. It's here, this point T. And why is it the same? It is not the same, geometrically speaking, at all. Why is it the same? Because the characteristic triangle can be written exactly in the same way using dy over dx. The structure of the differential calculus is the one which gives an ontology, a reality, to what is being drawn. think of it now in terms of modern terminology, what is being here proved is the cycloid is just an excuse. It is a very general idea claiming that when you take differential calculus, you don't have to make precise which are your variable and which are your constant. You just have to think in terms of differential, whatever the main variables are, and you compute. So, in fact, this is the first proof of the so-called chain theorem of Leibniz. I mean, the derivative of a function of a function. Interestingly, in the literature, I mean, the mathematical literature, this drawing will disappear. I know of no drawing in most mathematical textbooks which are using a drawing to show, to prove, to make understand this idea of the derivative of a function, the chain rule. So what do I mean now? I mean that the drawing we have seen is a sketch for this, what, concept, computation, idea, that's the main theorem of differential calculus. And you see how it changes the world. I mean, mathematical world, there's nothing else. In the sense that a curve has its intrinsic properties, you compare curves by various frames of reference, but within the different frames of reference, there is something which is invariant. A computation is working the same way, whatever you take, Cartesian coordinates or curve, how could I say otherwise, curve coordinates. Now, that's what I wanted to show, this idea of the sketch of an idea. Yes, the sketch of what? More than an idea. The sketch of what mathematics for curves means. And I end with, just to show you that kind of drawings, sketches were important to a mathematician, to a person like Jean Bernoulli. And I would like to show you an interesting thing, a part of this manuscript, which is how he explains a problem of de maximis et minimis, okay? He makes a nice story, Viator and so on. A traveler is walking on a ground which is very soft, and arriving at a ground which is very hard. He wants to go there, he leaves from there, which is the best way he has to take. And the best way he will take will be like the light in two homogeneous places, and this is refraction law and so on. But look at the way, so the amusing drawing and so on, but at the same time, something which is not new, but interesting in itself. Mathematics enters in the real world. When I was thinking of naturalization, logic being natural, now it's mathematics is not a language outside the world. It is within the world. That was precisely what the first sketch of Bernoulli was saying. And one thing, perhaps, concerning the Kantian argument about Anschauung and a priori, which ends the construction of the concept, one thing which is lacking is there is no method explained. There is no objective. There is no aim. In mathematics, the aim, the objective, is a method, and that's a sketch. What you want to obtain, not in the exact only what you want, but the way you hope to obtain it. And perhaps you have to remember that this was long ago said by Plato in Theaetetus, when it is explained when Socrates is asking Theaetetus about the method used by Theodorus, and then what and which is a classification of the square root of 2, 3, 5, 7 up to square root of 17. Remember the idea, the words being used by Socrates, Aristai. Go ahead, oh you dear children, you are on the good, the nice way, the good way. Socrates doesn't know the way, but the sketch explained shows that yes, there is a hope to classify all irrational numbers. You can sketch a proof as soon as you can find a way to hope there will be a result. So that's what I wanted to show about, and in a very simple, because I couldn't use a difficult thing, precisely because natural thinking, thinking of your own mind, was precisely the dramatic change which Gilbert Pascal had discovered. Well, now the spider, the example of the spider, as opposed to the bees eternally reconstructing the same thing, the spider had disappeared. It is only the image of the spider on old books, around old books, which are no longer useful. This is precisely what you find in a thesis illustrated by Jean Bernoulli just in 1700 in Basel. There was a spider on along the books of Aristotle. Thank you.
So in my view, that was a really an amazing insight into the dialectics of an impossibility of a sketch and coming from behind, so to speak. One could add one thing. As mathematics is a tool of nature, a kind of mimesis of nature, one could add the ideology of this time, nothing in vain. The nature does never anything in vain. Nihil frustra. As mathematics is close to nature, it cannot use sketches in the first meaning, as you mentioned it. And so we have time for at least two sharp, short questions. Irving.
So if I understand well, the question is thinking, non-thinking concerning sketches, invention, and so on. And there was an answer. There was an answer by Kant, distinguishing between analytical judgments, you don't think, you write, to be too quick. And there is the concept being constructed a priori by the intuition. What I wanted to show is there exists a thinking which it can be called a sketch, but it is a hope, a method, an aim, Well, you have to use psychological terms, a kind of enthusiasm. You have to do it, and this is not a priori.
Is there, please, the last.
Well, is it normal for a man like Pascal to think he's able to create a new thinking, a new world in mathematics, without being inspired or governed by God? First point. So, second point, and that's more or less what Gilbert is trying to explain. Now, if you say that you don't think, but you just let your human nature, your human mind, who is obviously directed, but how? By God. But if you let your human mind, your human nature expresses itself, you get truth. So, esprit de géométrie and esprit de finesse is perhaps for the world, when you are working with other human beings at the court. Esprit de géométrie is, even with what Pascal says, is what comes from your deep, yourself, as a man having a reason and using it. I'm trying to reverse the usual appreciation of esprit de finesse, esprit de géométrie, but I think that if you look at this thing, where it is located in the pensée de Pascal, it is the esprit de géométrie which is the most important, not the esprit de finesse.
The nature of time enforces us not to sketch anymore. So thank you very much. Notwithstanding the, in this theoretical outlet, the theoretical impossibility of a sketch, the question of theory and practice is on another level arising, and it might be that Michael Mahoney also deals with this. He teaches for decades as professor of history and philosophy of science in Princeton. He has been offered an almost endless list of academic honors, fellowships, grants, and memberships in scientific societies, among them, lastly, the Académie Internationale d'Histoire des Sciences. What is all the more impressive is that he has worked intensively in the development and the historization of computer programs like Unix, and that he belongs to the rare group of historians who bridge easily the Middle Ages with the computer age and who are able to activate questions which one would not at first glance direct to the sciences, like gender. Perhaps his most successful book is on the mathematical career of Pierre de Fermat. Recently, he has undertaken studies on the history of measuring. Among these studies, charting the globe and tracking the heavens is to appear.
Please. One's always in suspense as to whether the technology will work. Let me begin, if I may, because you will have seen my abstract for this talk, by saying what I'm, or just pointing to what I'm not going to talk about. As Horst Bredekamp pointed out, the study of the visual imagery of scientific development in the 17th century has been a recent interest of historians of science, and I think has redefined some problems, especially with sketching. But one is used to seeing the finished plates of Vesalius's Fabrica. One's used to seeing those marvelous copper plate engravings of Robert Hooke's Micrographia. But what should be of interest to us is the sketches that we know Vesalius was making as he was anatomizing, the sketches that Hooke must have been drawing as he was looking through the microscope, the sketches that we know Galileo was drawing when he was looking through the telescope, working with the hand to train the eye as to find out just what it was seeing. It's a wonderful topic. I wish I knew something about it. I could talk to you on the subject. But that kind of sketching, that thinking with the hand, that thinking, trying to capture nature in a moment of its action, is also reflected in another form of sketching in the 17th century, which is sketching through models. Now, we've talked about models. Irving mentioned the Bozzetti that had brought him, really brought him into the field. Here we see an example of modeling from a early plate in Domenico di Fontana's account of moving the obelisk. Namely, these are demonstration models of other proposals for raising, for moving the obelisk, for lowering it, bringing it around to the front, and then raising it again. And what is striking about almost all these other models is that they could never have worked. They couldn't have worked because they would never scale up. For one thing, humans don't come that large, and humans are essential to the operation of these things. Secondly, most of these would have collapsed under their own weight had they actually been built to full size. And it's interesting that the two new sciences of Galileo starts off with the question of the scaling of models to full size and the question of why machines in the large do not work as well as machines in the small. So one sees throughout the 17th century, and I'll come back to it, this notion of modeling, I call it modeling the large in the small. But there's another kind of modeling that's going on, and that's modeling the small and the large, that's trying to understand the world that can't be got at directly by the use of models and then reasoning down to the small. The great example of this is what I consider one of the great literary sketches of the 17th century, Descartes' Le Monde, ou Traité de la Lumière, which is the sketch of a philosophy of a new world of matter in motion, a radically reduced world in which there is only matter broken up into small pieces moving around in a constant vertical motion. And Descartes' argument is we can explain everything on the basis of those mechanisms if we get the right laws of motion, the right laws of interaction. It has to be a sketch. He doesn't know how to fill in the details. All he can do is rough it out. And here we see him turning to models in the large, that is, containers of small of balls, to try to understand how a pressure of light might pass straight through a medium. He turns to the hourglass to show how the sand flows. What he is trying to do here is provide analogies in the world of experience to get at the world beyond, below experience, indeed, the world that explains experience itself, that is, the model of his ultimate model of light explains how it is we see and have a perception of light. And here, for example, he uses mechanical models, here a pulley with several ropes, and here a mechanism which he's trying to show how light rays could cross one another in the way air would cross one another if people were blowing into various holes simultaneously. Right? Again, he's trying to explain ideas on the basis of experience, but he's trying to explain a world in the small. Now, as I said, Descartes' world is sketchy. It doesn't supply the details. He's not sure of what the mechanisms are, but in particular, it's sketchy because it lacks the mathematical structure and precision that he promised for his philosophy. This was to be a mathematical philosophy. And for that, he needed a mechanics that tied matter in motion to observable mechanisms that would give insight into the underlying structures of reality at the same time that one could test those insights by building mechanisms. And the figure most responsible for carrying this out is Christian Huygens. Now, Huygens is unusual for many reasons. One, he was a skilled draftsman, and he drew a lot. And secondly, the editors of his papers made the wonderful decision to reproduce in the published version not redrawn diagrams, but the original diagrams. So we can, these are all by Huygens' hands. Every drawing you see this afternoon, this morning, excuse me, every drawing I show you was one drawn by Huygens. And Huygens worked in both directions. We have here a drawing he made on 20 January 1675. You may not be able to read that Greek up here, but you can read it there, Heureka. His father called him Monarchimed, and Huygens apparently took it seriously, so all of his great discoveries are marked Heureka. This is the coiled spring balance for regulating a watch. This is his first drawing of that coiled spring balance and his first rough sketch of a mechanism. He then articulates the mechanism in two different ways. He tries a little counterbalance wheel there and then finally draws these diagrams of the mechanism. Now, what happens here is really interesting, and we have a note. He said, I went looking for the clockmaker Isaac Thiré to build me a model. I couldn't find him at first, but when I finally found him, I explained it to him. He, hardly understanding it, could scarcely believe it was true. But he built me a model, and I took the model and left. Thiré then built another model and started to develop another model that was aimed at getting that mechanism into a watch and built a working watch. Thiré then claimed, when Huygens sought a privilege for this invention, Thiré claimed credit. Now, Huygens' argument was, but he barely understood what I showed him. Thiré said, what I understood what he was doing, I built a model. And clearly he did, because if Huygens showed him the sketch, Huygens must have taken the sketch and the model with him when he left, and Thiré was able to turn around and build another model. I think we have here a wonderful socio-epistemological problem. What is it that Huygens thought he was showing Thiré? What did Thiré have to understand? And what did each man not understand of what the other was doing? Now, I want to just raise that as an issue, but I want to get down to some other sketching by Huygens, and in particular, this question of how the mechanism becomes a working mechanism is I think, a part of a whole new area of research we have got to carry out about the relations of scholar and craftsman in the scientific revolution. The last word has not even begun to be said about that subject, and it is encapsulated in this episode. Now, I want to talk about some fairly detailed stuff, in particular the mathematical structure, what it is that led Huygens to his Heureka. But I want to emphasize here the importance. There'll be a quiz on this in coffee break. The importance of this work, because what I'm about to talk about is going to get into detail, and you may wonder, well, gee, that's nice, but that what does it have to do with anything? Huygens devoted his entire life to the building of a clock that was accurate enough, reliable enough, and strong enough to be used to determine longitude at sea. From his very first pendulum clock, in which he figured out how to hang a pendulum on a clock, through his discovery of the cycloidal pendulum, his work on the center of oscillation and the sliding weight to adjust the clock, and the various designs of marine clocks, the subject dominated his life. The subject is also a filter through which an earlier agenda of research passes and becomes a new agenda of research that leads out to classical mechanics. And it passes through this filter of Huygens' work on the clock. So that is the overriding importance of the details I'm going to be getting to. Now, Irving, is this scratched out enough for you? Irving has been complaining that no one has a sketch that shows some real rethinking. I would like to concentrate on this drawing right up here. So let's bring that up. Huygens wanted to figure out what the period of a simple pendulum was. So he began by drawing a picture of the pendulum. Moved, he says, through a very small arc, but it's drawn reasonably large in order that we can see what's going on mathematically. On that drawing of the clock, he then wants to compare the speed, the time of the fall through this arc with the time of the fall, free fall, through the radius, through the string length of the pendulum. So he starts the body off at k and lets it drop, And first thing he does is to draw here this line, a semi-parabola, which is the Galileo's parabola of velocities acquired in falling. And then he draws another curve here. And let's take a look at that curve, because he gives us a diagram for it. This is the parabola of fall. And this curve is so constructed that this line length is the inverse of this one. That is, what he's doing is essentially turning velocity inside out, inverting it to get the time that takes a body to fall at the speed that is acquired in free fall at that point. Now we go back to the diagram. Now, he's got another diagram. The problem is here that the body falling along the arc of the circle is not in free fall. It has to travel along the tangent, and that's going to affect its time of fall. So he computes what that, the ratio of the time is going to be, and he winds up drawing a curve out here that represents the time of fall of the bob along the pendulum arc. Okay, now he has a diagram out there, and this is the equation he winds up with, the relationship, which is a problem for him because bx, be, and bd are all unknowns. They're all variable, and he has to be able to reduce this relationship. So to reduce it, he concentrates first on these pair of curves down here, and he brings up another diagram, draws off to the side another diagram. It turns out that if the arc of the circle were in fact the arc of a parabola congruent to the parabola of fall of times, then the product of these two abscissas will be a constant times the arc of that of the chord of that circle. So he's able to reduce two unknowns to one if the arc of the pendulum bob were a parabola. So he says, well, let's assume for the time being that it is a parabola. After all, we're making an approximation. So back to the diagram. And now he says, this has to be the arc of a parabola similar to this one, and he calculates exactly what that parabola is. That has now changed this relationship here to one that's more manageable, and eventually comes down to finding the area under this curve. Now, this curve having been transformed to a form that he can handle mathematically, and for that, he has another diagram in which he is able to show, this is a reduced form, that is, some of the basic parameters have been left out, in which he shows that this area under the curve is to the rectangle here, as the semi-circumference of the circle is to this diameter, or as pi. So he's back now. He has to make certain adjustments. But basically, that result allows him now to determine that, as an approximation, the pendulum's period is a constant pi times the square root of the length. That's the equivalent form of it. Here's where it gets interesting. This is already a mathematical tour de force in terms of the mathematics of the period. But here's where it really gets interesting. This was an approximate relationship, and he asks, well, I would like a pendulum bob to swing out the same period no matter how high it rises, because this is going to be on board ship, and you're going to never tell which way it's going to roll. What would it take to make this exact, this relationship of those two curves? What would it take to make the parabola that I substitute for the arc of the circle not an approximation, but an exact relationship? To find out, he goes in. Oops, I'm sorry. He goes in and unpacks the way in which he had arrived at the relationships in the first place. I can't go into details. But basically, he's not misled to think, well, I'll just put the parabola for the arc of the circle. He rather unpacks how he got the various relationships that led him to want the parabola. Basically, he says, I have to have it so that BD, the normal, is to BC, the ordinate, as EC, a constant length, is to CF, which is this ordinate, to the curve itself, to the parabola. So what curve must this be in order that that ratio give me a parabola as the result? And then, no warning, he says it's a cycloid from its known tangent properties. And you go, how, where did it come from? Whatever made him think the cycloid? He's begun to draw one in here. Well, if you look at this diagram carefully, look what we got. You'll know this from Jean d'Ombre's picture. Here is your generating circle, and here's your outline of the cycloid. Cycloid, in a sense, had been staring at him in the diagram. And I want to argue that that's the hint he needed. The drawing had not, in fact, had anything to do with cycloids when he started. But he winds up in a sketch with the basic structure of a cycloid. One of the beauties of sketches is that they're not exact. They leave room for approximation. Sorry. Okay. Sorry, this is where I wanted to be. He now goes on then to redraw the diagram with the curve as a cycloid, and then reconstitutes his proof. And he is able to show then that if a pendulum bob is constrained to swing along a cycloid, then its period will indeed be independent of its amplitude. The question is, how do you get a pendulum to swing that way? And it turns out that if you take a cord and wrap it around a cycloid and then unfold the cord, always keeping a tangent to the cycloid, the curve you generate will be a cycloid congruent to the original. So if you want to keep a pendulum bob on a cycloid, you just build two cycloidal leaves at the point of suspension of the pendulum and let the cord wrap around it. And as it does, it will pull the pendulum bob up onto a cycloid. So he's got his cycloidal clock, cycloidal leaves. Now, this work was done in the late 1650s. It led to various other kinds of work on the clock. I want to jump forward in time. The early 1670s. I think as he's working out the final version of his great work on the pendulum clock, when he discovers or he works out what the dynamic properties on the cycloid are that lead to this property of tautochronic motion. And it comes to the conclusion that a body, no matter where placed on an inverted cycloid, will take the same time to reach the bottom, is because the accelerating force on the body is proportional to its arc length from dead center. So the force to restore is proportional to the distance from equilibrium. That is the property of the cycloid. He believes it explains the cycloid's property of tautochronic motion. One of the first things he does is to go to the stretched string, which he knows to be a tautochronic mechanism, to vibrate evenly. And in a series of drawings, uses the cycloid as a model for analyzing the motion of the string. So what we have is mathematical modeling of tautochronic motion trying to see if he can get a mathematical analysis of a known instance of it. The nice thing about this sketch is that this is supposed to be an inextensible string. And yet, he wants to have a triangle in here. So the mathematics, the sketching, allows him to create, as it were, a virtual triangle to make counterfactual differentiations that he needs to carry out the mathematical analysis. A little bit later, within a year, he thought about that principle, that the force on the bob is proportional to the arc length. The force is proportional to the distance from equilibrium. He read Hooke and Hooke's announcement of the law of springs, ut tensio sic vis. That is, the greater the displacement from equilibrium, the greater the force to restore. And so now the spring, the leaf spring, the helical spring, and the coil spring become mechanical models of the tautochronic motion of which the cycloid is a mathematical example. And so we see now a series of experiments using springs. Let me back up for a second. Yeah, we see now a series of experiments in which he tries to apply the spring, and I've shown you the drawings. As he went from these drawings then to that little drawing of a coiled spring with balance arm to the mechanism for a spring-regulated balance. Now he goes in other directions at this time. Well, a few years later, he comes up with the idea of what he calls his tricord pendulum, which is a ring suspended with three cords, which you then give a twist to, and it will oscillate tautochronically. And he tries to work out the mathematics of that, and that requires understanding the curve that would be struck out by this point as the ring is twisted and rises, and you get a curve wrapped around the surface of a cylinder. And here, he works out the dynamics of that, trying to show that the motion would be tautochronic if this curve were a parabola. And then he goes to work out the mathematics of that curve by now a standard trick. This is not a cycloid in this case. What he's doing is taking what would be a circle here and then expanding it in order to unfold the surface to see what the curve was, and to satisfy himself that though the curve is not, in fact, a parabola, it is close enough to a parabola down here to give him the motion he's looking for. So he's playing with various forms of motion, modeling mathematically, but always keeping the physical object in mind. And indeed, he built a tricord pendulum mechanism to show that it would, in fact, work. Later on, he pursues what he calls the balancier marin parfait, the perfect marine balance, meaning a tautochronic mechanism that could withstand the rigors of sea. By this point, he has gone from the cycloid to this notion of what he calls incitation parfaite, perfect incitation. What he means by that is the restorative force is proportional to the distance from equilibrium. And now begins to sketch various mechanisms for which this would apply. And here he has the idea of you take a globe, you wrap a string around it, and you hang weights. In this case now, as you set it in motion oscillating, it will pick up weights as it swings to the left, and the amount of weight it picked up will be the proportional to the distance that it's been moved. So you have another example of incitation parfaite. But what is interesting here is to contrast it with the drawing of this with his original coil spring drawing. And you can, again, see these models in mind as he's thinking through the problem. This is the coiled spring. This is another version of a simple harmonic oscillator. He never uses that term. But this is a version of the simple harmonic oscillator. And you can see the design factor being continued. Here, indeed, he now takes the mechanism, turns it on its side, wraps the cord around a rod. You can see a clockwork beginning here. Here would be a support for the string, and here's the sketch of an escapement wheel. Only now what he's doing, instead of using chains, lifting weights, he's got cylinder is immersed in mercury. Hydargyri is this word. And they'll be raised and lowered, and by the amount they're withdrawn, the force will increase, and you'll have the same thing as you have the chain mechanism. And here, to make it even more directly applicable to a clock, he takes the mercury and puts it in a closed cylinder and adjusts the mechanism. He's thinking of the clock, but he's also working toward the mathematics. Here, his conical pendulum, this is working with evolutes. He has to constrain the curve of the motion to a paraboloid back from the circle. Here he uses this motion of evoluted unfolding curves, such as the cycloid, but here he turns back to his newly discovered chain mechanism, sketching his way to a solution. Now, if I may, I'll just move very quickly. Another problem with a clock is adjusting it. And that's a problem of dealing with the fact that the simple pendulum of mathematical abstraction is a weightless cord and a bob where all of the mass is concentrated in the center. But real clocks have real bobs attached to real bars. So he has to work out the center of oscillation of a compound pendulum. This is his first drawing, simply using two weights and trying to figure his way through it. This is the more interesting. This is a derivation of the center of oscillation of a rod. And what he does, he breaks the rod up into individual pieces. On this side, we have a pendulum. This is a physical picture. He takes the center of gravity, measures it here, drops it through an arc. They will acquire speeds. At this point, he imagines all of the connections being loosened and each of these bobs being directed upward by a 45-degree plane to reach then the height it would reach given the speed it's acquired. We would say today, on this side, this is the curve of kinetic energy. The center of gravity of this curve has got to match, of this system of disconnected bodies, has got to match the center of gravity of the connected bodies, and that is what enables them then to figure out what the simple pendulum is corresponding to this compound pendulum. Now, what's important here is this shift, this interface between the physical picture, mathematical abstraction. To show you where it leads, here is proposition 41 of Newton's Principia. This is the physical orbit. This is the dividing line. This is the curve of forces. This is the curve of time. And these are auxiliary diagrams, the areas under which allow Newton to plot the position of the body on its trajectory at any given time under an arbitrary law of force. Physical picture interfaced to a mathematical picture. One sees that being developed in Huygens. It is no wonder that Newton acknowledged Huygens, among all others, as an inspiration. What gets interesting from the point of what Jean d'Olmo was talking about is if we take this diagram and look at its next instantiation, there's Newton's physical picture reversed. Where is the mathematics? Where is the geometry? It's gone. No, it's not. It's changed form. It's now in the language of Leibniz's calculus, a language that I would argue allows another kind of sketching. It's the kind of sketching that allows you to play with concepts by algebraic manipulation, to move from work to energy by way of force and momentum, and to see how they play out with one another. One is pursuing another set of representations. The language of sketching changes. But this pursuit of mathematical models that allow one to talk about a world that one cannot reach, the world that one believes to underlie reality itself, to talk about that world in ways that one can then test against experience. So the model becomes an interface. The mathematics becomes an interface between those two worlds. What we see in Christian Huygens in particular, but I think this example could be multiplied if we only had the documents, what we see is that process beginning in 17th century. Thank you.
Yes, I'll. So would you please repeat the question?
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. That was an amazing insight into the processing from the tactile to the most abstract mathematical diagrams, which I personally have never seen in these really step-by-step procedure. Other questions? Did you understand me? No. Other questions, objections, please.
Well, I think these are. I'm sorry. I'm the one with the mic. What am I working on? I'm not used to being wired, at least not in that way. The question was the relationship between sketches and diagrams. And when would you call a diagram a sketch or a sketch a diagram? And I think to some extent what one is seeing here are sketches, some of which indeed become diagrams in the finished work. And I could take several of these diagrams, or these sketches, and show you the way they become finished diagrams. But in the process of finishing them as diagrams, largely for expository purposes, the heuristics will disappear. And I think one of the differences is that sketches retain the heuristics. It's why Irving keeps insisting that he wants to see erasures, he wants to see things crossed out, because what gets crossed out are the false steps. Right? So sketches, for example, will contain lines that were originally drawn because one was exploring a relationship. It was a dead end. So it will disappear in the finished diagram. So diagrams are, I think, a fairly unreliable way of getting at what the person was thinking, or certainly not nearly as reliable as getting that sketch.
It is all the more kind of disaster that in all the great publications, you mentioned Galileo, the monumental Favaro edition, everything is omitted that changes, that gives the impression that a drawing is a sketch. So just the outer lines are redrawn and then stamped. So everything that is that gives the kind of impression of the nervousness of the hand, one could psychologize what we saw in the drawings of Huygens. All that is omitted in almost every edition I do know about the great spirits of the 17th century and also afterwards. Yeah. So the psychology of creating is categorically up to now omitted, and that's why what you showed us was so revealing in my view. But maybe you should answer from your perspective what you just saw.
Jean, why don't you come up and just use the mic?
But there is something which you have to think in the terms of use the word model for mathematics. I think the sketch was the beginning of a model, but once it has been found, it's no longer a model, it is reality. That is, the dx, the dy are there, physical objects. So now, once Favaro, or think of everybody at the end of the 19th century, they got the impression that they were reproducing not the creation, but the reality which the genius like Leibniz had done. This was a new world, but a physical world. So,
Irving. Sorry.
In his own hand.
That was a decision of the editors of Huygens' Oeuvre Complète. that instead of redrawing the diagrams, they would make photocopies of the diagrams as found in the manuscripts. They are the only Œuvre complète I know of for 17th century science that decided to do that. Even Tom Whiteside in the Mathematical Papers of Isaac Newton redrew all of Newton's diagrams instead of showing us Newton's hand at work. Hold you in suspense. What I was trying to show was that in this particular line of research on the clock, Huygens had the ideal mechanism for tying the mathematical to the physical. Because in so many cases, his working mechanisms are simply instantiations in real material of underlying mathematical shapes. The cycloidal leaves, the sliding weight. The mathematics translates to the physical in a very direct way with the mechanisms he's dealing with. And that's why I wanted to show you that diagram at the end that leads to the Newton. That line down the middle of the page in which an outline of the physical situation becomes the mathematical as the objects pass through the interface. So the mathematical relations get mapped on the physical relations. If you were to go off to the left in that diagram and start to build mechanisms, you're not, that's a pendulum. So put a rod on it, put a bob on it, put something up at the top. Those are the evolute of the cycloid. Over here is the cycloid. So the mathematical meets the physical. And I think one of the reasons that mathematicians at the end of the 17th century make the shift from Newton's diagram to Varignon's and go from the geometry to the algebraic is precisely because the mathematical abstractions are beginning to involve so many different dimensions, force, momentum, what have you, that you can't find room for them on a diagram. Newton is in several of the diagrams, the propositions in the first book of the Principia are there only because Newton loses parameters when he goes from the discontinuous to the continuous, and he has to find a new construction to relocate a measure on the diagram. The calculus obviates the need for that. You simply write a differential equation, and you can work in several dimensions simultaneously. So I think this is a moment in time, no pun intended, in which the physical and the mathematical are joined. The link was close. Yeah, if the link were so close, then there wouldn't have been the problem with the clockmaker. The link is close in Huygens' mind. I've had a long conversation with John Leopold, who is the man who knows everything there is to know about Huygens' clocks. And Leopold points out, Huygens was never prepared to deal with the materiality of the clock. He gave up on the spring because the spring has this annoying habit of changing its properties owing to changing temperature and changing humidity. The solution to the spring-driven mechanism, John Harrison's solution, is not about math, it's about mixing metals. And Huygens wanted nothing to do with the chem lab. So it's a very mathematical view. And he has trouble with artisans precisely because the material is something he doesn't want to deal with. Let me get back to your first question real quick.
I'm afraid...
This is a quick answer.
Good.
Quick answer. This is what ties the 17th century to the 20th. Why are those dated? Money. Money. Patents. Right? He's documenting his work because clockmakers have a habit of wanting a cut in the profits. How can I believe that at any time?
Okay, if we don't make a pause, I get signs we will pull from this podium with a haptical force. So the discussion will be, the next half of the section will be reopened at exactly 11:30. Now there is tea waiting for us in the Fout Hall. Thank you very much.